Really looking forward to this pygeoapi presentation. This is a bit of software that's really gotten a lot of notice. And it's essential in OGC sprints and other activities around the globe. So looking forward to it, Tom.
Great, thanks. Thanks, George, for the intro, and thanks for inviting us to talk. We're very happy to be here. So this presentation will be was to be delivered by Francesco and I. So Francesco, I will keep going until you are in, and then I'll be able to move things over to you accordingly. So basically, I'm going to give a presentation on pygeoapi. So given George's introduction, as well as Martin's presentation, I mean, very good overviews of OGC and open standards and open source, as well as the Apache SIS implementation. Here in pygeoapi, we're going to dive a little deeper into the API side. So sort of the publishing and accessing and discovering things through an open source Python server implementation. So we're going to walk over, where sort of geospatial APIs have been and what their evolution is. We'll talk a little bit about some of the current technologies that are driving some of the OGC activity with regards to APIs. We'll talk. We'll give you an introduction to the project, the pygeoapi. We'll walk through some core capabilities. Give you some information on how you can install this and run it. As well as provide some examples. So, I mean, in my opinion, that there's implementations are a great example of lowering the barrier to the standards implementation. So, we'll show you some examples of production instances, where we're going, and hopefully we'll be able to give a demo following that. Francesco, I do see you now. But are you able to speak?
Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So when it's my side, I can talk.
Excellent. Thank goodness. Okay, so next slide. I will move on to the evolution of geospatial APIs. So geospatial sort of web APIs have been around, as George said, quite a long time. The first generation of OGC standards are decades old with regards to the APIs, and they were built at a time where things like XML RPC, SOAP, WSDL, UDDI were very, very popular and popular implementation and design patterns. There was a strong concept of a relational database as the back end. Obviously, relational databases have not gone away, but there's other things these days, such as document stores, NoSQL, and so on. So, in the 90s, we saw the first standard of OGC WMS 1.0 in 1999, which I remember looking back at that and saying to myself, "Oh my goodness, this is the future." So it was great to see that as sort of the first. Major web mapping spec coming out of OGC. Moving along into the 2000s, mid 2000s, we had the concepts of Web 2. Suddenly, we have Google Maps, the concepts of AJAX, and asynchronous sort of workflows. Maps as tiles. So the first iteration of doing maps on the web with OGC WMS was based on being able to look for any part in the world, any data in the world, any bounding box, any width and height, aspect ratio, and you get a result back. Slippy maps and tiles started to come in to address help out with some issues on getting canned representations of that data in support of performance. All the while, the OGC API specifications start continue to evolve. So we went from maps, which are, you know, basically pretty pictures of geospatial data. We got into features or vector data. We also got into gridded data or coverages, if you will. Generic processes, so doing workflows and chaining through through OGC standards, as well as catalog services for you know, for search, for discovery. So where did that get us? As George said, there's you know, over a million you know, implementations out there. There's numerous organizations deploying these things. They're not going away anytime soon. At the same time, the API standards, you know, there were some realities that are associated with them. You know, things around HTTP tunnels and using XML or GML, which is great and still, you know, still useful and still required. But, you know, there are some limitations with that with regards to moving things over the web. Here's a typical example of what a GML payload will look like. Some other realities. We found that we wanted to make our APIs more search engine friendly and mass market friendly. And we also found that the first generation OGC specs were somewhat challenging for the non-geospatial web developer, and that increasingly becomes important as we tried, I guess, as an overall community to make geospatial more ubiquitous in mainstream IT. So I'll move it over to Francesco now to give us a talk about where we are today in terms of all these approaches.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. So we have then discovered, as George explained before, that the evolution of geospatial API is actually here. And more importantly, we have specific peculiarities just in place. So we have the HTTP communication protocol, which is based on a REST model, and it is stateless. Next, please, Tom. Thank you. And we actually now we have to use HTTP verbs for the different operation on the same resource. And we have also HTTP codes for the responses, which can return different payloads based on different media types. So for instance, HTML and JSON are now the default in most of the new generation OGC API specification. And also more importantly, URI, which identify uniquely a resource that we are going to consume with such approach. And then another flavor is JSON, which is easy to handle and very popular among developers, so that in most cases, the first choice for RESTful web services is such format, and in particular for the geospatial stuff with the GeoJSON. And then last but not least, the OpenAPI specification, which is basically a way to describe a web API in terms of its endpoints, in terms of the request parameters, the responses, and the schemas, and so on. It is basically a language agnostic in its semantics, and it was born and formerly known as a swagger, which is actually the rendered HTML page of an OpenAPI document. So next, please. This is a typical example of the header of an OpenAPI JSON document. And that next, please. And then we have, as said, the Swagger tool, which is a robust tooling, strongly developer-oriented, which gives some nice features like automated documentation. We'll see it later in the demo, and also the ability to test the APIs and generate a certain point the client could to consume the endpoint automatically. Next, please.
Okay, so I'll carry on to the next section. So, given the fact that we've talked about where geospatial web APIs have come from and where and where they're at, as well as some of the technology patterns of today, I'll talk a little bit about what's going on in OGC, sort of supplementing what George has mentioned in George's talk earlier. Whoops. So in 2017, the W3C published the spatial data on the web best practices. Basically, this is a very important paper, which you know, everybody's welcome to and encouraged to read. This is about how to make geospatial data webby and putting things on the web, making them available through through APIs and identifiers and access mechanisms and so on. So really foundational piece of work here from W3C. Again, the design patterns, you know, being web friendly, being developer friendly, using, you know, HTTP, the specification directly as it was, you know, as intended, and moving to this, you know, pattern of modular specification development where we have core and we have extensions. So, you know, a lot of times we don't need the 100% solution and just the, you know, there's a minimum viable product that can be realized through a core specification that may not do everything that everybody needs to do, but it'll catch, it'll capture and make things a lot easier for a great majority while giving, you know, the rest of us or other you know, zealots like me, let's say, more specialized capability to do more specialized things through APIs. In terms of timeline, again, the W3C paper, the OGC API white paper came out in 2017, which basically talked a lot about similar things that we talked about here. And in 2018, we saw a lot of activity from OGC on putting these things into action and coming up with, you know, hackathons and code sprints, which to this day continued, and as George mentioned, I mean, there's one going on right now. And here's a look at, for those of you who are familiar with the OGC standards, so whether you're dealing with vector data, raster data, maps, tiles, search, there's an equivalent for a lot of what we've done in the OGC on the API side moving forward. Here's one I think that I certainly like. I mean, the activity, there's a lot of OGC activity on GitHub. So now I can go on GitHub and see the state of the specification at any given time, and I can fork it, and then I can make a contribution to it if I want to. So the standards are released as HTML. The sources are actually on GitHub. The issues behind a lot of the discussions on those standards are going on at GitHub. On GitHub, as well as, you know, there's a lot of them use Gitter as a chat capability. So this really lowered the barrier, in my opinion, for a lot more people to get involved in the development of the specifications, as well as implementing clients, servers, parsers, serializers, and you know, and what have you. So here we are. And you know, because of all that, I think it's important to talk about where we came from and you know, how far the OGC has come, especially in addressing the need for more modern APIs. I think we've done a great job, and we've tried to follow that wave along with a lot of other implementations to implement these APIs. So here's pygeoapi. So pygeoapi is a server implementation of a lot of the OGC API standards. It's an OSGeo community project. So we got community project status last summer, and we continue to work with OSGeo to bring us to a full-fledged OSGeo project status. So what's this project all about? Again, it's an API framework. It's primarily based around web APIs, but the way it's built, you can actually run it on the command line to do what you need to do to, you know, access your data or discover it or process it or whatever else. You can also implement it because it's an API framework. You can also make your own application and implement it there. So you can put your own front end on top of that. So it's very flexible that way. And it should be clear that not only can you leverage pygeoapi, but pygeoapi actually leverages a lot of open source tooling underneath, which we'll show later on. We're OGC compliant to the OGC API features specification, and we continue to pursue compliance on all the APIs that we implement in the project. So being compliant is important for us. In fact, we're a reference implementation for OGC API features. So I think that gives I think that's great for the project to demonstrate to others the that we pass all the compliance tests, and people can be confident that when they're deploying the project like pygeoapi with this, which is compliant, there it'll do what they think it's going to do with regards to the standards. There's a lot of developers that can the developer team continues to grow across many countries and many time zones. And again, we stand on the shoulders of numerous open source implementations. So one key point about pygeoapi is we don't touch any data. So imagine you have a geospatial database or geopackage files or some geotiffs or netcdfs or what have you. All we do is publish it. We don't change anything into it. We don't play around with any of the values or the data types of the values. Where it is simply a publishing mechanism. So you take your data and you put it on the shelf through through pygeoapi. It's maybe I'll go on to the diagram and talk a little bit about how it's put all together. So at a high level, there is the core in the middle, and that is actually that's the Python API. So everything's written in Python, and there's a configuration that drives everything. The configuration is a YAML format. Underneath the core, there's a concept that we're calling providers, and you can basically attach geospatial data or catalogs or what have you through these different providers, which are available through, you know, if you have CSV data, let's say you have a GeoJSON file, which we've heard earlier on today, or some relational database, you basically use these providers or adapters and you plug them into pygeoapi through a configuration. So you don't have to touch any code or anything like that. You set up a configuration file, tell it where your data is, give us a little bit of information about what kind of data it is, and then the project makes it available through the web front ends up top. So if you're into Python, you're probably aware of various web frameworks such as Flask or Django or Starlette for asynchronous. So we provide web front ends from front ends to that as well. So the core part is in the middle, is the part that I was saying you can run it on the command line, or you can integrate it into your own application. A little bit more about the core and provider approach. The entire project, again written in Python, is based on a sort of a factory pattern where there's an idea of a robust plugin mechanism. So anybody can write a pygeoapi plugin that simply has to meet an abstract base class specification. And once you do that and you meet the API requirements from the Python sense, then you're good to go. So something like Apache Sys. I mean, I'm excited to have conversations with Martin and others on seeing what kind of things Apache Sys can do and how we can plug them into pygeoapi and make them available through the web. some examples of our plugin. So anybody can write a plugin. It doesn't have to be in the project. You can run it from your own location and just reference it from pygeoapi. The plugins do have to be Python, obviously. Having said this, pygeoapi provides a number of off-the-shelf plugins that get shipped with the software, so you don't have to do any additional tooling. So here you can see that a number of vector data providers are provided with the software up front. So I mentioned around standing on the shoulders of many successful projects, Phosphor G projects. So GDAL, OGR is one of our core providers. So that ubiquitous tool has enabled so many projects in the geospatial sort of ecosystem, and pygeoapi is no exception. So we support that, which in turn allows the project to support hundreds of different vector formats. Recently, in the last few months, we've gotten into coverages. So we can also, for those of you that are into multidimensional data, we're able to deal with gridded data or coverages. So we currently have support for Rasterio backends, and as well as something called X-Array, which allows for slicing and dicing, very efficient slicing and dicing of multi-dimensional data such as NetCDF. So we also have the coverage capabilities. We also have tile providers. So we talked about doing map tiles, and we've recently implemented tile providers. So if you have a tile set, so you generated a geospatial set of map tiles, You can simply point pygeoapi either locally on a disk where those tiles are, or you can point it to Minio or some other object storage, which can be remote, and pygeoapi will integrate that just the same, so that you can serve your map tiles out with confidence. Another part of the project, so we mentioned around the standards and the APIs being webby. pygeoapi for all of the APIs provides an HTML interface, a relatively simple one, but it's there and it is extensible. You can make your own HTML templates, which would end up looking a little bit more pretty than what we will see in the demo. But the other important part is that we also support the concepts of cschema.org and linked data. So you can go and do structured data queries on Google dataset search, for example, and have your data more easily accessible through search engines as a result. At this point, I will move it back over to Francesco.
Thanks, Tom. So Tom has talked about this pluggable architecture, no? But what does the core offer in terms of capabilities? So we can say that the core capabilities of pygeoapi are tightly related to the set of new generation of OGC API specification that you want to implement, in the sense that in the config file that the pygeoapi rely on, you can just configure the OpenAPI specification that you want to implement. So if you want to implement OGC API features versus tiles versus coverage, it's just a matter of declare those endpoints, those resources, and declare the types of OGC API implementation that you want to publish to pygeoapi. So next, please. And this is actually the Swagger HTML renderer that I talked briefly before. Here, it's clearly a common core capability, because pygeoapi can offer in one of its endpoints can offer the ability to provide an open API document as a JSON encoded payload or this HTML page, which was formerly known as the Swagger page. And through that, I can show you later how this work. People can try the request, so he can obviously request for the metadata that are going to publish by GeoAPI, or directly call an OGC API for feature dataset or tile, vector tile, or different stuff like that. Next, please. So one of the most important capability is the OGC API feature, which is actually the most mature implementation from the OGC. And we will talk about that later, also how this specification is going to expand itself with additional functionality for the transaction and for advanced SQL filter mechanism. It is worth also to mention that PyGeo API is already officially compliant with this specification, and we have also a specific automated job on our CI infrastructure to maintain this compliance. Next, please. Recently, we have introduced the OGC API coverages for handling multidimensional raster data with the support of cover JSON payload and for the metadata, and also we have implemented the OGC API tiles specification. You have seen before that there is a pluggable backend provider for having an object storage or a local directory tree to just publishing vector tiles. Next, please. We have also processes which are supported by PyGeo API that allows to deploy a backend process defined as it can be run as a job and eventually, obviously, with a post method claim for call the run of the job in async or async mode and get back the result. Next, please. And last but not least, we are also supporting spatiotemporal asset catalog, which is a metadata OpenAPI-based, still OpenAPI-based specification for a catalog of raster data. Next, please. Next, please. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the different way to deploy the PyGeo API. There are several ways to make it happen, and I would say that obviously much depends on what you want to achieve and how your infrastructure is designed to work. We have several possibility. One of these is the ability to use pygeoapi as a library. So, for example, you can install it from pygeoapi or the Conda repository and use as a library for your downstream project. But also, pygeoapi is shipped as a native package on Ubuntu GIS and FreeBSD. And obviously, we are also supporting a Docker infrastructure, and then you can just fetch get a pygeoapi image to run a container, and the procedure is quite simple. In fact, this is, in my opinion, one of the most interesting options to deploy pygeoapi because it is handy and allows also to have different, to have flexibility and to have different solutions to scale up pygeoapi. I will talk about it in a while. Recently, it has been added also, next please, the capability to have pygeoapi from an OSGeo Live distribution, which is basically a DVD or an image that you can spin up, and you can find the most important open source GIS software all together for a quick try. So coming back to the Docker infrastructure, we say that we have Docker images, and those images are published on Docker Hub. So you can just grab these images and just test locally your pygeoapi implementation or deploy on your own server, or natively on the cloud. So we can support cloud infrastructure like AWS, Azure, and Google Cloud Platform. These allow to stress the concept of the horizontal scalability and give us also some For instance, some corner cases where you can come up with a configuration, for example, with just one resource in the pygeoapi configuration, so that you can, at a certain point, easily set up an auto-scaling for the consumption of your web API with just one single collection. And
again,
this is...
we're going to get cut off in about 2 minutes, right?
So, okay, thank you. Yeah. I'll skip a little bit. So next, please. And okay, we can skip. This is just an example of the command to have quickly a Docker image up and running. We have several production instances. I don't know if Tom want to talk about that.
I'm wondering whether, we have many production instances here at the Weather Service of Canada, as well as other organizations. I'm wondering whether with the time left, we should do like some Q&A, question and answer. If anybody has any questions, otherwise we can use the remaining time for a demo.
Don't see any questions in chat. I have questions, but maybe the demo would be most appreciated. You can do it in 2 minutes because I'm going to have to go to the next session.
Yeah, sure.
Are you able to share your screen, Francesco?
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Are you seeing my screen?
Yeah.
Okay, this is the actually the landing page of a pygeoapi instance where I have configured just two collection. In this landing page, we have the collection that can have or can have as a different backend providers to publish features rather than tiles or coverages. And there is also the, and this is also the entry point to browse spatiotemporal asset catalog or processes. And obviously we have the Swagger page or the JSON format with the OpenAPI document. If I go here, for example, I have two resources. One is lakes, and for example, if I go here, I can try out the resource. I ask for a payload JSON formatted. I'm going to execute the request, and I go back the links for the nested resources of this collection. So back in the actual HTML page, this is something that can happen in the rendered page. So here I'm going to ask the same request as before, but I'm going to ask the HTML format. And if I go here in the view, I'm going just to ask, okay, pygeoapi, give all the feature that belongs to that belong to this collection, and I just get the paginated result in the HTML page. But obviously, I can ask also the JSON formatted payload, and I get back obviously a GeoJSON. Just before the end, I want just to display in this specific collection, I have also configured, there isn't the vector tiles here because probably the backend is broken or is down. But here, obviously, I'm going to ask for this specific collection, which has a backend provider for tiles, to return the configured mapbox vector tile for the collection, and so I can say that here we can obviously trying to match the old, let's say, the legacy web services, so both the WFS and the WMS, but in a modern modern result with a more performant way with the vector tiles. I think probably we don't have much more time to go forward with.
Sounds good. I guess people are on to the next chat. So if anybody else has any questions, feel free to find us. We're on the Gitter chat where we posted it. We posted it somewhere here in the chat, but just look for pygeoapi Gitter and
we're probably there. Sorry, Tom. Probably we can show the last presentation slide with some links.
Good idea.
It's mine. Sorry. Okay, are you seeing my screen? So here we are several links. I think the more important is the Gitter chat here, where people can ask for help. There is the main list, and obviously the Docker infrastructure where you can get the pygeoapi images, and there are links for the demo. I would say that it's very interesting to have a look at the demo with where there is a COVID-19 demonstration with a backend of an ESRI ArcGIS remote server and also a CSV remote file from a GitHub repository. And I think that that's all.
Great. Okay. Thanks, Francesco. And thanks for everybody. Thanks for listening. And I hope everybody enjoys the rest of the geospatial track and the rest of ApacheCon. Thank you.
Yeah, me too. Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Bye.